listening to America's favorite radio program, The Occident Hour of Smiles, starring your old softie, Bert Healy!
Smile, Bertie, smile!
Right, Wacky, smile, darn you, smile! Say, Wacky, who's that who just walked into our WEAF studio?
Why, it's none other than the wealthy industrialist and Wall Street tycoon, Oliver Warbles.
Now, Oliver Warbucks, I understand that you have something to tell the folks at home about wonderful little Annie here.
Yes, good evening, Bert Healy. Annie is an 11-year-old foundling who was left by her parents on the steps of New York's municipal orphanage on the night of December 31st, 1922.
And aren't you now conducting a coast-to-coast nationwide search for Annie's parents?
Yes, Bert Healy. I am now conducting a coast-to-coast nationwide search for Annie's parents. Drop page. Furthermore, I am offering a certified check for $50,000 to any persons who can prove that they are Annie's parents.
Wow!
Wow! So, Annie's parents, if you're listening in, write to Oliver Warbucks at...
At my home. At my home... At my home, Bert Healy. At 987 Fifth Avenue, New York, New York. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank the makers of all new Occident toothpaste with Miracle L64 to fight bad breath for letting me appear here this evening. And I just did a damn commercial, Grace. I've never endorsed a product.
Hey, Mr. Healy, is your time once again for the lovely Boylan sisters?
It most certainly is, Wacky. Well, I can see by the old clock on the wall that another of our Thursday night get-togethers has gone by faster than you can say, Occident!
O-Y-D-E-N-T!
The toothpaste of the stars!
To make your teeth Hollywood bright!
So for all of the Armor of Smiles family,
Vanny, Bob, and Connie,
the lovely Boylan sisters, Fred McCracken,
Jimmy Johnson, radio's only masked announcer.
This is Bert Healy saying ha, 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 ha. Hey, poor woman, hey, dapper dam, you both got your style, but brother, you're never fully dressed without a smile. Your clothes may be of Romani, they stand out a mile, but brother, you're never fully dressed without a smile. Who cares what thou wearing on Main Street or Savile Row? It's what you wear from ear to ear, and not from head to toe, that matters. So senator,
so
janitor,
so
long for a while, remember you're never fully dressed without a smile.
Ready or not, here he goes. Listen to Bert tap his smiling toes.
Thank you.
Your clothes may be a go, Romilly.
Ain't old man, ain't upper than you both got your style. Like brother, you're never fully dressed without a smile. Your clothes pretty, your family, they stand at a mile. But brother, you're never fully dressed without a smile. Who cares what you're wearing?
Roosters.
Oh, you can't stop!
know a guy up in Brooklyn who can doctor up a fake birth certificate or any other papers you want. But we need your help, sis.
For details about any that can help us pull this thing off.
I can help you. A lot. But what's in it for me, Ralph?
Three-way split, Aggie.
Half. Half? Half.
Half, 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 half. Straight down the middle. $25,000 each. But we gotta do it fast, Aggie. You know, give me some of the old rooster razzle dazzle, in and out, 2 or 3 minutes at the most. Get the money, get the kid, get the hell out of town.
The kid, that's the problem. What do we do with her afterward?
Aggie, that's no problem.
When the rooster wants someone to disappear, they disappear.
For good.
On a snowball to China.
Rooster, no!
Come on, Aggie. We get the $50,000. We blow this crummy town. And then Lil and me, we'll meet you.
Secretary of the Treasury,
Morgan Ball.
Secretary of the Interior,
yes.
My friend and aide,
Louis Howe.
Now, Oliver, since you speak for those happy few Americans who have any money left, I'd like to begin with your view on matters.
Mr. President, in the words of Calvin Coolidge, the business of this country is
business.
Yes, yes, and for the good of you, the country, Wall Street, and me, we've got to get my factories open and the workers back to work.
Well, according to my latest figures, there are 15 million out of work, and 50 million, a whopping 40% of the country, with no visible means of support.
Mr. President, if I may say so, unemployment is not our biggest problem. The dispatches from Germany are becoming more and more disturbing each day. There could be war.
Germany, hell, people are starving in this country.
Harold, I know that, but in the long run...
Cordell, for people who are starving, there is no long run.
The trouble is, it's all happening at once. The stock market has taken another nosedive.
Sit down, strikes, riots.
Floods, dust storms.
Well, at least we're all agreed on one thing. The situation is hopeless and getting worse.
Henry, I'd like to see those figures.
You cannot make that without the display that's working against it. Now, this is not the other issue.
Settle them out. It's tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow. That'll be sun.
Quiet, little girl.
What did you say, Annie? Oh, go ahead, my dear. It's still a free country.
Just thinking about tomorrow. Clears away the cobwebs and the sorrow. Till there's none. When I'm stuck with the day that's gray and lonely, I just think of my jean and green and sigh. The sun will come out tomorrow.
Now, Harold, sing.
Sing?
Yes, sing like Annie. I've just decided that if my administration is going to be anything, it's going to be optimistic about the future of this country. Now, sing.
But really, frankly,
sing. Yeah.
The sun will come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow there'll be sorrow.
Perkins!
Just here!
So for the president, when I'm stuck with a day that's gray and lonely, I just stick out my chin, I stick up my chin and grin and say, everybody, Republicans to order, sing.
The sun will come out tomorrow, so you gotta hang on till tomorrow.
Outside house, all claiming to be Annie's parents.
Oh, boy!
Have begun to screen them, suggest you return to New York immediately, signed Grace Farrell.
Well, it looks as though the Hour of Smiles has more listeners than we thought, man.
Gee, hundreds of couples. One of them is bound to be my mother and father.
Well, Oliver, you'd better get back to New York at once.
Yes, Mr. President, if you don't mind, Annie.
Goodbye, everyone.
Goodbye, Annie.
Goodbye, Mr. President, and thank you.
No, thank you, Annie. You're the kind of person a president should have around him.
Annie?
Mr. President,
yes?
What if we set up 1,000 new federal projects?
Dan!
Yes.
Howard.
Yes.
New post offices.
Yes. And put the unemployed back to work building them.
Or we could create 5 million new jobs in less than 6 months.
And weekly paychecks would get all those millions off relief and back to paying taxes.
We'll build a country so strong that nobody, including Chancellor Hitler, will ever be able to defeat us in a war.
Mr. President, what we need to give this country is nothing short of a new outlook.
A new horizon.
A new approach.
A new concept.
A new dedication.
A new vision.
A new spirit.
A new attitude.
A new deal. Gentlemen, I was right the first time. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself. Tomorrow!
his mother and 619 men who said that they were her father. That makes
1,236.
All liars. But Drake, I never realized there were so many dishonest people on the island of Manhattan.
Some of them were from the Bronx.
Grace, we're back!
Where are they, Miss Dale? Where are the people?
They're gone, dear. Come and gone. I'm sorry, Annie, but they were all liars and fakes. After nothing but the $50,000.
Are you certain?
Yes, sir. None of them knew about the locket. I'm so sorry.
Gee, I thought for sure somebody was going to be my mother and father.
Mr. Warbucks, this just came, my special messenger from the FBI.
Ah, finally. Elliot Ness has located the manufacturer of Annie's locket in Utica, New York.
Oh, boy!
That sort of locket was manufactured between 1918 and 1924. Sort of locket? Yes, over 90,000 were made and sold.
90,000?
Annie, I'm afraid the gist of it is that Ness doesn't think there's a chance in a million of tracing your parents to the locket. I'm sorry.
It's okay, Mr. Warbucks. I mean, gee, you did the best you could. I guess a kid can get along without the folks.
Excuse us, sir. We'll go check on the dinner menu.
Annie, can we have a man-to-man talk? Someday, one way or another, I was going to be rich. Very rich.
That was a good idea.
Anyway, making money is all I've ever given a damn about. And I might as well tell you, Annie, I was ruthless to those I had to climb over to get to the top. Because I've always believed one thing. You don't have to be nice to the people you meet on the way up if you're not coming back down again. But lately you've made me realize something. No matter how many limousines or paintings you've got, you have no one to share them with. You might as well be broke and back in Hell's Kitchen. Do you understand what I'm trying to say?
Sure.
Good.
Kind of.
Kind of?
I guess not.
I've made me a fortune, that fortune made ten, in headline and profiled again and again. But something was missing, I never quite knew. That something was someone, but who? My speeches are greeted with thunderous acclaim, tattooed universities bearing my name. Yet something was missing each time I got through. That something was someone, but who?
Something is no one. Everything in you.
do is proceed.
Sir!
What?
Sir.
Excuse us, folks. We don't mean to interrupt.
Sir, look. There's our Annie.
Who are you?
Honey, where are your mom and dad?
Mudge. Mudge is the name. Ralph Mudge. And this here's the wife, Shirley.
Oh, you never know it, dear, but you're Annie Mudge.
Annie Mudge. We were sick and broke, honey, and didn't know which way to turn. And a man gave us a chance to work on his farm up in Canada.
Well, we couldn't bring no baby.
We loved you, Annie, but we had to leave you behind.
Mr. Mudge, is it? We've met a great number of people who claim to be Annie's parents.
Proof! I expect you'll be wanting proof of who we are. Here's our driver's licenses and Annie's birth certificate.
Baby girl. Name, Anne Elizabeth Mudge. Born to Ralph and Shirley Mudge. New York, New York, October 28th, 1922.
October 28th? That's my birthday.
It wasn't her note, sir.
Yes, I know, but I still don't understand. Sister, please, you gotta believe us. We got in on the Greyhound this afternoon and went straight to the orphanage to fetch our Annie, and the lady there said our baby was up here.
All the years I dreamed of holding you in my arms again.
Mr. Mudge. On the night that Annie was left at the orphanage,
oh,
was there
here's something you wouldn't know about. When we left Annie at the orphanage, we left half a locket with her and kept the other half till one day.
Oh, Ralph, before. Look! And she's wearing it!
And here's the half we kept, and it fits perfectly.
Come on, Ralph, she's at home.
She is. She seems to be. Well, if you'll gather anything, I guess we'll be taking her home.
No.
Take her. Just a moment, Mr. Mudge. What about the money?
Money? Well, sir, we ain't got much, but we'd be glad to give you.
You haven't heard that I've offered a certified check for $50,000 to any persons who can prove they're Annie's parents?
No, sir, we don't know nothing about no check. Anyway, we don't want no money for Annie.
Right. We don't want no money for Annie.
On the other hand, Cheryl, remember that little pig farm out in New Jersey? With $50,000, we can afford to buy it.
Bring Annie up right. In the country, with fresh air, fresh eggs.
Fresh ham.
Fresh ham. Certified, huh?
All we gotta do is make it out to ourselves.
That's correct. Tomorrow morning?
Tomorrow morning?
Yes. You wouldn't mind if Annie stayed here until tomorrow? Christmas.
Christmas.
Then you can come back to pick up Annie and the check.
Oh.
Oh.
Any objection to that?
No, sir. Whatever you prefer, sir. We ought to get back to our hotel then, Noah.
Goodbye, Annie.
Goodbye. Until tomorrow, honey, and then you'll be spending the rest of your life with us. Whoops, pardon me, Tootsie. Merry Christmas.
Season's greetings, one and all.
Well, Annie, this is wonderful news. Annie has found her parents, and they seem to be a very nice couple.
Yes.
You're lucky, Annie.
Right. I'm lucky. Just think, New Jersey.
Mrs. Greer, champagne.
Yes, sir.
We must celebrate because it's Christmas Eve and we've just had the most wonderful news in the world. Annie has found her mother and father. Everyone, I propose a toast. To Annie Mudge.
Annie Mudge.
Annie!
Oh, ho, ho, Merry Christmas! I seem to have the same effect on everyone. I've lost her. I've lost Annie.
Sir, that Mr. Mudge. I think I've seen him someplace before. I have a feeling he's not who he says he is.
Mr. President, Oliver Franklin. Franklin, I need your help.
Of course, anything I can do for you.
Comes the dawn. Now it all fits together.
Annie? Annie, come look at this.
Leaping lizards! Who would have guessed?
Show it to the president.
Sir, Mr. and Mrs. Mudge. Show them in, Drake.
With pleasure, sir.
Drake! Won't you please come in, Mr. and Mrs. Mudge?
Good morning.
Good morning.
And Merry Christmas, one and all.
Merry Christmas. Look, sure, there she is, our little girl.
Your little girl.
Hi, Mom. Hi, Dad.
Well, we don't want to bother you on Christmas and all. Just come to pick up her Annie. Yeah. And oh, the check.
Oh, of course, the check. I almost forgot. Here it is, Mr. Munch. $50,000 certified.
Certified?
Certified.
Paid to the order of Ralph Munch.
Read it again.
Paid to the order of the jig is up.
Yes, the jig is up. Daniel Francis Hannigan, also known as...
Rooster Hannigan, also known as Ralph Mudge, also known as Danny the Dip.
Frank, will you turn them over?
Yes, sir.
The whole thing goes up, holly, fa la 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 la. Tis the season to be jolly, fa la 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 la.
So go to Warbucks and you'll find this woman's there accomplice, fa la 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 la. Arrest her too, please.
Me? I never seen these people till yesterday.
Oh, come off it, Aggie.
Yes, sis. If Lil and me is taking a fall, so are you.
I ain't never done nothing to you. I always been a big...
My dear, the jig is up!
Annie! Annie, tell them all how good and how nice I always been to you.
Gee, I'm sorry, Miss Hannigan, but remember the one thing you always taught me?
Never tell a lie!
Rat! I'll let you in on a secret! I never liked you, you little gold digger! And I never liked any of you either!
Your days are numbered.
Annie, you'd like to meet your friends.
Okay, kids. This is Mr. Daddy Warbucks. Hi, honey.
Hi, kids.
Oh, and this is the President of the United States.
Children, Miss Hannigan is gone for good.
Yay!
And you're not going to have to work anymore.
Yay!
Instead, you'll have classrooms and teachers.
Yay! Oh. No more bus! No more bus! No more bus!
Yes, girls. For you, and well, perhaps for all of us, this Christmas is going to be the beginning of a wonderful new life. I know the depression's depressing.
The carols are still, the stores are filled.
And the windows are minus their dressing.
The children don't grin, the Santas are thin.
And I've heard a terrible rumor.
No good will, no cheer.
But we'll get a new deal for Christmas this year.
Are there.
But Santa's got brand new assistance.